Hi, I'm Adrienne Clarkson, and I'm here with Margaret Atwood, and we have something interesting for you today, and I'll let her tell you about it.
Yes, the interesting thing we have for you today is the first in a series of shows on books that are going out through the National Art Center Performing Artists platform, which was set up as an emergency device to help artists who suddenly find themselves unable to do public performances or any of the things they usually do. And we added on to that through Facebook Live, which has given $100,000 to the National Art Center to allow authors to come on the platform and do readings and do interviews and get paid for it. And we are introducing this program. It is a bit of an improvisation. But we'll tell you, that's what it is. And then in the future, you're going to see lots of different artists and different authors and their books from the spring and summer lists, people who are unable to do standard book launches.
We feel it's very important that people know that you can still read and that their people are still writing. And there are many people writing their second, third book, but there's some people writing their first books. And it's very important that people know that they can get them, they can read them, and keep up with everything. Just because we are under physical distancing doesn't mean that we're not keeping up our intellectual closeness and our interest in everything that's happening in Canada in terms of literature and the arts. And that's why I'm very happy that my friend Peggy invited me to be with her today to talk about a lot of books that we haven't had the chance to read yet, I'll be honest with you, but we know some of the authors and their other books, and we're excited by some of the new authors and some of the things they're writing about. So I think it's a wonderful idea, and I'm very happy that we're able to do it. I do have to preface it by the fact that Margaret Atwood and I have known each other now for 62 years, so that if you feel that you're into an intimate conversation or overhearing one, that's because we simply have known each other for that length of time. Thank you for inviting me to do it, Peggy.
You don't say privately invited, you say dragged me into it.
Yeah, I always say yes. Whenever she asks me, I say yes.
Yeah.
Anyway, I'm worried about you.
Yeah, since when have I ever been? It's usually you dragging me in. Come on, be honest.
Oh, no. Well, let's not have that discussion here. I want to know where you were. I was concerned about you because you were doing your rock star tour in New Zealand, Australia. I knew, first of all, I was worried about you being in the fires. And then I was worried because you were going on to Ireland. And then there was disease starting. And I thought, will she get home? And how did you get home? What was that about?
Well, I got home just in time because all of these places that I was in, and I did 11 shows in New Zealand and Australia, the disease had not hit those places yet. So people were not that aware of it. And when I was in Ireland, it had not even hit Ireland quite yet. I think there were maybe 2 reported cases. But when I came back through Heathrow, it was empty. You know, it was just vacant. So people in England had already gotten quite worried. I think I got back just in the nick of time, and I think you did too, didn't you?
Yeah, we were in Jamaica for a week, and we came back on March the 7th, and we thought, there's something going on, and we came in, and there was not a rush, but then 2-3 days later, it all really started, and I was very glad that we were at home, and as you and I both travel a lot, we know how difficult it is, even under the best of circumstances, to travel. Airports are not a delight anywhere in the world. Airplanes are not a delight anywhere in the world. And so initially it seemed like a little relief that one wouldn't be able to go anywhere, but now it's become very serious. And I think it's going to make great changes for us. And it's interesting to be talking about new books and writers now, because I think in many ways a landscape will change slightly now that we've had this particular event and we're going to live through it.
So both you and I back in the past.
Then.
Oh, said the ghost of Christmas past, your past. You had a stint in publishing and so did I. So we're aware of all of the things that authors and publishers have done over the years to get the books out there and get the authors known. You and I were there before there were any festivals, before there were many readings. Readings were usually in coffee houses when we began, and then they were in bookstores, then they were in universities. There weren't any of these big reading programs. So we've seen all of that spring up. And those are the things that authors can't do at the moment because they involve personal presence.
And now I think really people have depended upon these festivals very much. And it's very collegial too, because our authors get to meet each other, not only Canadian ones, but the Canadian ones get to mix with the international ones. And it's always very interesting to think that the landscape will have changed now that we have done this. And let's see what comes out of it in terms of what kind of platforms we can give to writers. And not just interviewing them perhaps, but certainly hearing them read is a good thing. And I think that is really very, very worthwhile. And I hope that this wonderful Facebook platform, which authors are going to be able to access, will mean that we will hear them, we'll be able to go to them and listen to them. And I think, after all, what were stories invented for? Sitting around the fire waiting, you know, to be sure that the tigers wouldn't come out of the woods and get you in the dark. So you had to keep each other awake with this marvelous storytelling. and that's what I think. Everybody still is a storyteller. Everybody is still a listener.
Yeah, and let us add in, of course, you can order books online.
Absolutely.
Order them, and they will get delivered. And some of the indie bookstores have got curbside pickup. You can order them over the phone or online, and they will, you know, spray them with bleach and put them out on the sidewalk.
Just a little Lysol wipe. But you can make your own. 5 tablespoons of bleach to 4 liters of water and put it in a spray bottle. And then you can spray everything. And you can spray the books in the hands of the bookseller as you pick the books up at the curbside, which I highly recommend.
Are you spraying people who come to your front door?
That's right. Not in the face. And I never spray you in the face when you come to the front door.
No, you don't. You don't. You don't. You give a fishy look to my hands, though. You wipe down the doorbell after I've rung it. I don't go into Adrienne's house. We'd social distance on her front porch, just to let you know.
So we live on the same street in Toronto, and so we frequently see each other. We walk and talk at a distance, each other's gardens. And now it's done at porch distance, and it is more than, I love that wonderful ad that said social distancing is 6 feet apart, 2 meters apart, or the length of a hockey stick. What could be more Canadian than that?
Oh, the length of a moose. I saw that one too. Right.
Well,
why don't you jump into our spring and summer book list? It's mostly spring, because some of the publishers said, don't count on summer. We may be postponing them to fall. But I know that these are out there and available because I looked them up. You can purchase these books, which I advise you to do. So you're going to talk first about Jill Adamson's Ridge Runner, which is published by House of Anansi Press. And I should explain that this all happened like in 2 days. So we were not able to get our hands on any actual books, but we're hoping that the show can put up some covers for you to see anyway. So we haven't read them. We just thought they, and we haven't actually even seen them.
We haven't touched them, which is also virtual. However, we will say, even we haven't touched them, read them, we do know the authors because we've read other things by them. So that's a little guarantee. And the reason I want to read Jill Adamson's Ridge Runner is that I so loved her first book, The Outlander. And then I had a chance to meet her at the Kingston Literary Fair. And we have a kind of interesting connection because I'm the Colonel in Chief of the Princess Patricia's Canadian Light Infantry. And her great-great-grandfather was Agar Adamson, who commanded the Princess Patricia's regiment in the First World War. And her uncles I went to Trinity College with. They were at Trinity University with me. And so I felt a little, when I saw her name and she'd written a book, you know, those when she wrote The Outlander, I thought, I have to read that book, see if she's any good. She is really good. And The Outlander was a beautiful book. It's a book about voyaging, really, of escape and running and discovery and geography. And she does that so beautifully. And of course, now there's this TV series called The Outlander. So people would object. I was quite excited when I first saw there was a TV thing. I thought it was Jill's book being made into a series, but it wasn't. But her title came out first. And now she's written this one about Ridge Runner. And again, it's a chase and an escape. And there will be a lot of topography and description in it. And I'm really looking forward to that. She does that so beautifully. So that's really one that I'm really looking forward to.
And I'm going to read that one too. So we should probably tell people where we are. You're in your kitchen with some beautiful.
I'm facing towards the French doors going out to the garden, and behind me you can't see the stove because it's behind that vase of tulips that I very cleverly put there to hide the bleach bottle and the other messes that might be. And those are my dried alliums from last summer, which are in a vase by Daniel Crichton, the great Canadian glass artist, which I very much treasure and always have in the kitchen with big, tall things in it. So I thought they made a nice background. And you are in your study?
I'm in my place where I write.
Ah. Yeah,
when I'm here, that's where I write. In the dark thing in the background is actually a bookcase. And then there's another desk there. And this desk that I'm sitting at is where my computer is.
Uh-huh.
Top right now of some interesting books.
Are you twittering from there? Is that where you twitter from?
Is that
from?
Where I twitter from? Sometimes from my phone, wherever it may happen to be, and sometimes from here. But beside me in the background, you can see a printer. A printer and various other stuff. What you can't see is the piles of books on the floor.
Well, I know. That's why I didn't do it from my study. I spared you the hideosity of that, which is I can barely make my way to my desk because when new books arrive, and I put them right on my desk thinking, I'll get to that right away because I really want to read that. And so they gradually pile up around me. And I don't have the heart to take them away because I think always I'm going to read those. I am right away. But, one can only do so much. I try to keep one or two things going at any given time. But I'm looking forward to reading some of the ones here. So for you, you have chosen something else as a first.
Yes, here's my next one. My next one is called Five Little Indians. It's published by HarperCollins. And the author's name is Good, G-O-O-D. And it's going to be about five children who went through residential school and what happened to them subsequently. So this was a snatch and grab that went on for years and years and years. I've got some child stealing in The Handmaid's Tale and The Testaments, but this was real child stealing in our country. And the author says in her write-up online that she doesn't mean this to be a lecture, she means it to be a story. It's like, what happened to people? So I will read that with great interest. Good, Five Little Indians. And
that
your
sounds
one is something that's of great personal interest to you.
That's
the Library of Legends.
Published by Harper Avenue and written by somebody who has a surname, Chang, which is the giveaway that she is Chinese. And it's about the Nanking Massacre. And that really interests me because it was a horrible event where the Japanese massacred Chinese in the city of Nanking. And my uncle was there at that time. He was a student and he did not get massacred, thank God. He lived through the takeover of China by the communist regime, then escaped and eventually came to Canada, where he adjusted very well because he was a civil engineer and he worked in the Department of Public Works in Ottawa all his career and is no longer unhappily with us. But he was a wonderful man and he shared something with you, Peggy.
What is that?
He read palms.
He was a palm reader. Oh, would that I have
palm. Yeah. Maybe so, if you'd met him, he'd have read yours.
And I would have read his.
But I'm really interested in reading that because I think that kind of history should not die And I think it's sometimes so enormous, an event of such enormity often can't be encapsulated by one or two or three people, even a film or a book. It has to be kept alive always because it's so gigantic, just like the Holocaust, the same kind of thing.
So we'll say the name again, The Library of Legends. The author's name is Chang, C-H-A-N-G, and it's Harper Avenue who is publishing it. And I'm going to read that one too. And you have another one that you want to talk about right now called Probably Ruby.
Probably Ruby is a very interesting prospect for me, I think, because it's been written by a Saskatchewan Métis. And it has all the things that I think we need to know about. We need to know about how Métis people are, what they are, what their history is, how different that is from our other Indigenous peoples. We have to know the subtleties of all of that. And I think our literature is now becoming able to grapple with all of it because the voices have been found. That's what literature is. It gives voice to people. So I'm really looking forward to reading reading this to see what will come out of it, because I know a lot about the history, but I think in fiction you get different points of view. It's not the same thing. You get an imaginative recreation, and that's what's so valuable about fiction. That's why you can't ever replace that, you know, and then what happened, and then what happened, and characters. So I'm really looking forward to her book.
Yes, and her name is Lisa Bird Wilson. Lisa Bird Wilson, Probably Ruby. And it's Probably Ruby because I believe that the central character has been adopted and doesn't even...
Yes, and doesn't, yeah, doesn't know...
And exactly then she discovers it. Yeah, and I know some people like that, believe it or not, who discovered.
Well, in the Indigenous community, because of you know, children being taken from their parents because of the residential schools, which is, you know, so horrifying a thing that your mind just can hardly get around it. I remember being with Thompson Highway at his place in northern Saskatchewan, and we sat on a dock, and he said to me, I was 6 years old, 7 years old, and 8 years old, and Renee and I would sit here, and we'd see the airplanes coming across the lake with the pontoons. And we knew they were going to come and take us away for 9 months to Winnipeg. And just the way he said, I've never forgotten it, that these little children, these little tiny children were taken away from their families and what happened to them. That's why the Truth and Reconciliation Commission is so important, and the implementation of those recommendations has got to happen.
Yes. Now we're going to have a slightly... different take on things. I actually have a book. I've actually got one of these.
Show it to me.
Show it to me.
It's Thomas King, of course. And I love Tom King. He's so great. He did the Masseys, just like you and I did. Yeah. He did the Masseys. He did a wonderful Massey lecture on stories that must be told. Truth must be told. Yeah.
This is not actually the book. I lied. called Obsidian, but the cover looks a lot like this. I have read Obsidian, but I lent it to somebody. Don't tell, I actually lent it to somebody. So Obsidian is the name of the book. It's in the Thump's Dreadful Water series. Dreadful Water is an Indigenous detective. I had a sort of moment of hallucination in which I thought Thump's is an anagram of Thomas, but it isn't. There's no in Thomas. So Thump's Dreadful Water, I think this is his sixth appearance, and Tom King is at the moment writing another one. So Obsidian is the one that's out right now, and Thump's is just as like laconic and ironic as he always is. You know that Tom used to do a radio show called the Dead Dog Cafe. So
yes, it was wonderful. I miss it. I still miss it. It was wonderful.
His dialogue is always very good. and very elusive. So somebody says something and somebody says something else and you think, what? What are they going to say? Oh, I get it now. So
but
life.
You see, I love that name, Dreadful Water, because it's funny and dark, darkly satiric and bitter at the same time. Because when I started doing the Fifth Estate in 1976, you know, that's 44 years ago, we had a file that we were working on called Grassy Narrows and about the terrible water in Grassy Narrows.
Yeah.
I opened the Globe and Mail about, you know, 2 months ago, and there's a thing saying terrible water at Grassy Narrows. What on earth are we doing? Why is that still happening? Why haven't we fixed that?
Yeah, why indeed?
How can we fix that?
Yeah, exactly. And that's not the only one.
No,
of course not. There's a lot of dreadful water around. So lots of fun.
I do like detective. I love detective.
Yeah, you do. Okay. Then you'll like.
I love detectives, and I'm a great Jack Reacher fan. So,
There you are.
I love everything everybody wants to find the truth out, and if there's death behind it, it's even better, isn't it?
You are a somewhat grim person.
Well, that's not the first time you've noticed that.
So you're going to talk about Kate Pullinger next. Kate Pullinger's book called Forest Green by Penguin Random.
Well, I think Kate Pullinger's a very, very interesting writer because she got the Governor General's Award a few years back, not while I was Governor General, I think it was the year or two after, for
Mistress of Nothing.
Something that was called Mistress of Nothing, which was a very engaging title.
Whoops.
No, I thought it was very, very good, and I'm looking forward to this one. So I'm just going to read it with a completely open mind because it's been some time, you know, maybe 8-9 years since I read anything of hers. So with people who write things that are, you know, every 3 or 4 years and you keep up, it's interesting. But when they haven't written something or you haven't read something of theirs for quite a while, it's quite fascinating to see. Whether it comes up to what you remember there, the other one was, which you loved. And I'll look forward to reading Kate Pullinger's book very much.
And the other one you wanted to talk about was The Night Piece by Andre Alexis.
Well, Andre Alexis is one of my really favorite writers. I think that 15 Dogs, which many people know and many people love, is one of the great novels. Because I really felt, you know, the reverse of what I feel in Disney films, where the animals are like people. I felt like a dog when I read Andre Alexis's book. He made me understand what it would be like to be a dog. And not only that, but he used Toronto, which we, you know, because if you've lived here for as long as you and I have, you know the city very well, and he's got the city in it, and it becomes such an interesting background. Hyde Park is so interesting with the 15 dogs in it, and the idea is just marvelous, and he writes so beautifully, and that's the thing, you know, books are about writing, and writing after all, everybody learns to read and write, sort of, I guess, but the reason why writers are writers and why we read them is that they bring that particular skill to something which is extraordinary. You know, not everyone can paint. That's the interesting thing. That's where they'd make the difference in the arts. Not everybody can write any music, but everybody can write something. And it's only the people who are what we call writers who make you want to read them that is extraordinary. And then when they find a theme like dogs, I just love that book so much. So I'm really looking forward to Night Piece. And I think it's a wonderful title, Night Piece. When I saw that, I thought, Night Piece, why does that sound both very familiar and yet something that I want to find out about? Night Piece. Lovely.
Is it like a little night music, possibly?
Maybe. There you've got it, perhaps. Yeah, maybe. A little night music. Yeah.
Little night music. So yeah. Night in itself, of course, is always interesting because it's mysterious. Night is dark, usually.
Night is dark, and night and silence, who is there? It's what we really, and all the place of dreams and so on. One of the wonderful things about this time is that many artistic organizations are making it a point of putting out platforms like the National Arts Center is for artists. And many people are putting out operas, you know, the Metropolitan Opera is putting out operas, Arte in France is putting out operas. And I saw Midsummer Night's Dream by Benjamin Britten, directed by Robert Carson at X Festival the other night, and it's available on YouTube. And again, there is the mysterious Midsummer Night and all the things that happen with magic. And I think night, yeah, I think to put night in a title is pretty good. Darkness is pretty good.
Juna Barnes from long ago. Nightwood.
Who?
Juna Barnes.
Oh, yes, Juna Barnes, of course. Didn't that have an influence on us when we were in university and reading? Juna Barnes was really important. Nightwood, that's marvelous.
Yeah, so moving along to my next book, I saw this title called The Baudelaire Okay, so I'm back. What happened? Both my potential internet connections went down, but little did they know there's a third one. So I'm now at the third one, which is higher up in the house, and we're ready to go again until something else fails. I think we are dealing with an overloaded internet. So over to you, Adrian, going to talk about how to pronounce knife.
I love that title. I just love that title. It's how to pronounce knife, right? And it's by Suvankam Tamvasana. And she started as a poet, I believe, but also she's dealing with questions about new Canadians, about how you come to a country and you have to learn all sorts of things, including the language and the customs. And I think these stories are going to be very, very interesting. You know, a lot of writers begin by writing short stories. They don't always plunge into novels. And I remember Rohinton Mystery, who's one of our finest Canadian writers, one of his first book was Tales from Burrosha Bag. And he wrote that when he was a clerk in a bank in Brampton, Ontario, which is a community just outside Toronto. And I always look forward to these short stories. I like the form of short stories. And I will be very much looking forward to this. And I see the matters, life in a nail salon and things like that. And I'm interested also because of my Institute for Canadian Citizenship, which is my legacy project as Governor General and deals with people who become new citizens and who, as soon as they become citizens, become part of our network of people who can join something called CANU, which means that you go on your phone and there's an app called CANU, C-A-N-O-O, and you are immediately joined up to 1,500 cultural institutions in Canada, all the national parks, the provincial parks. You get 50% off on the lowest fare on Via Rail, and that's good for 1 year for your family as soon as you become a citizen and your family up to 4 children. So I think, you know, I'm in contact with so many new Canadians. We have a program of special citizenship ceremonies, and you've participated in it, Peggy. And it's wonderful to me to see the people that are coming in any citizenship ceremony of 48 people. They come from 28 different countries, and that's what Canada is. And that's why I love to see that you get to the point where you can write in Canadian for Canadians. And that's why I'm looking forward so much to Suvankam's book.
Yeah, so that's how to pronounce knife, and it's McClelland and Stewart as the publisher. And my next book is called Kill the Mall, as in shopping mall. And it's by Pasha Mala. His previous work I've read and I liked it then and think he's pretty funny. But, you know, I have a very ambiguous relationship with shopping malls.
You do?
Well, you can get lost in them.
I can't stand them.
Wandering around them. You might get trapped. So I'm I'll be very interested to read this one, Pashamala. It's House of Anansi Press, and it's called Kill the Mall. It's not called Kill in the Mall. That could be a different.
No, I just want to say that House of Anansi really does put out the most interesting, often interesting, because the number of books here for a small publisher, really, they put out Adamson. And they do the Massey lectures that you and I have both been involved with, and I think it's very interesting to see their list. They're consistently doing very, very interesting things. They're sort of the new boy on the block.
But, well, no, they're not, Adrian.
I know you started it ages ago. I know, but it's rebirthed. You know, like I think of it as rebirth. The Venus on the shell of Botticelli.
Yes, well, it went through a number of different stages. At one point, one of its owners wanted it to publish nothing but books about chess. Did you know that?
You're making that up.
Not.
You're making that up.
Hand on heart. Where is that thing?
I can't believe it.
Totally true.
Even somebody who is crazy enough to buy a book publishing company isn't going to want to do books about chess.
That is what they wanted to do. But let's move on. Yes. It has been through many different incarnations, and recently, of course, it's Scott Griffin who rescued it from oblivion.
Absolutely.
And has built it up, and he also does that wonderful
poetry reciting contest,
which has been wildly successful.
With the high school students all across the country, French and English.
Yeah, Le Voix de la Poésie and Poetry and Voice are the two names. So finally, in the fiction department, you're going to talk about The Certainties, published by Knopf Canada, and the author's called Hunter, H-U-N-T-E-R. What drew you to this title?
Well, what drew me to the title is that I did a biography of Norman Bethune for the Extraordinary Canadian series, edited by a writer called John Ralston Saul, and was very happy to do the Bethune, because I happened to be at his desk one day when he was talking with Penguin about doing what 18 they would do, and they were doing the list, and I saw the list of everybody, and there was Marshall McLuhan and Lord Beaverbrook and Lucy Maud Montgomery, and I saw Norman Bethune, and I said, do you think I could do the Norman Bethune? So what could he do? Anyway, I did do the Norman Bethune. And the Spanish Civil War has always been a big thing for me, as it was. I'm sure you were involved too when we were younger and we were at university. There were a lot of the veterans of the Spanish Civil War still around, and they would have meetings, and I got quite involved with them. And our friend Rick Salutin, who I know we're going to be talking about later, wrote a play about the McDonald Papineau Brigade. That was the brigade that went from Canada to the Spanish Civil War. And I knew a number of them. They were, a lot of them had, were out of working class Finnish backgrounds from Northern Ontario. They were still trying to get recognized as having done something interesting and worthwhile in the world, because they went there as fascism was prefigured in Franco before Hitler. And Norman Bethune was a doctor who was a Canadian and went over there and developed a blood transfusion service that saved so many lives. And he was a fascinating character. And to me, he's truly one of the three or four most extraordinary Canadians who's ever lived. He ended up in China helping Mao Zedong. Millions of Chinese know his name in Chinese transliteration. And he died there at the age of 48. Of blood poisoning, operating on the front lines, fighting the Japanese. And I just thought he was extraordinary. So anything about the Spanish Civil War, I will read in any language. And it's, to me, one of the great events of the 20th century. So I'm looking forward to this very much, The Certainties.
Well, as you probably know, the people who went to the Spanish Civil War from Canada did so illegally.
Exactly.
Supposed to be going there. And then when they came back, and then Hitler started up, they weren't allowed to join the army because they were called premature anti-fascists. Don't you love it?
I love it.
So with Hitler, it was okay to be anti-fascist, but somehow they had been premature. They had done it too early.
Well, it was very thrilling for me after working with them for many years that when I was Governor General in 2001, there was finally a monument dedicated to them. on Rideau Drive, on Sussex Drive, where everybody came, including some of the very, very old veterans. So there's a monument there to them, and I'm really happy and pleased about that.
So we're both going to be reading The Certainties by Hunter, published by Knopf Canada. And now we're going to turn in desperation. In desperation.
Yeah.
And at the last minute, Adrian said, but there isn't any nonfiction. We have to do some. So you came up with
nonfiction.
And the first
one
that we're going to talk about is one that you are insisting that I read. I don't know why you're insisting that I read this book.
Well, I was reading
Successful Aging.
It's called Successful Aging.
Haven't we done that? Why do I have to read a book about it? Tell me.
Well, we don't really have to read a book about it, except it's so fascinating. And it tells you how the brain works. And I immediately thought of you because you're so interested in everything to do with science. You're my guide into science and how the brain works. Yeah. You know, you bugged me about that. And I thought, this is a book for Peggy. And it really was so interesting because he tells you about how your brain operates. And he says, no, forget about the crossword puzzles and doing that sort of thing. What you really need to do is put together your emotional feelings together with your intellectual capabilities. This is me summarizing in two silly sentences. And then you will be able to keep yourself motivated to learn more things, to do more things, to keep involved. And he's somebody who was trained at McGill, and then he got snaffled off by the Americans, but he has written this book called Successful Aging, and I really recommend it to everybody. It's a very fascinating read, and I think something it's just so good. And then one of the lines he says is, what you must do is to continue to make younger friends, which you and I have both always done, because that's the way we've worked and that's the way our life has been. But I think it's terribly important to have younger friends. I mean, not just children and grandchildren, because that's a different kind of relationship, but younger friends. You know, you meet somebody younger and you think, I can be friends with them. And it's amazing how many people feel trapped by their age group. Ageism just isn't with younger people towards older. Ageism often is older people thinking, I can only be friends with people who have been through what I have been and know what a Glenn Miller song. And that's not true. It's very important for people to be open always to the new, and you get a lot of different vocabulary and the different experiences. I really recommend Successful Aging because that's one that I have read.
And his name
I hope you will read it.
His name is?
Daniel Levitin.
Levitin.
Yeah.
Daniel Levitin, Successful Aging. And I've always thought of you as a younger friend, Adrian.
Well, so am I of you. You always seem to be younger than me. And you are by 5 months.
That is true. It's true.
Now, the world knows that.
Exactly. Yeah.
However, we are now both over 80. So
5 months. I think maybe a little bit more than that. You were born in February, yes?
Six,
February, March, April, May, June, July, August, September,
November,
October.
9 months.
Yes, more like
just it. Just enough difference to make, in the Chinese horoscope calendar, you are a rabbit and yes. I'm a tiger.
Yes, yeah. That's it in a nutshell, isn't it? Now you're going to talk about...
I don't know about that. My mother didn't want... Yes, let's go on. Next subject. Yes.
She didn't want a tiger baby, but how lucky she was. Anyway, rabbits can be quite ferocious if you bother them. Rabbits can be ferocious if you bother them too much.
Oh, of course.
Yes, they bite. Those teeth. Yes.
Those teeth. And because they look so cuddly.
That has always been my problem, Adrian, looking cuddly.
I never saw that as a problem. I don't think it's a problem.
No. It's a bit of a problem.
Skin We're In by Desmond Cole.
Yes.
Who used to write for the Star.
Yeah. Oh, yeah,
he used to write for the Star. Yeah, and I used to read that article, that column all the time. And it's basically about endemic racism. and racism that people don't even think about or dismiss, et cetera. And he talks about what it's like to be Black and to be Black in Canada in very compelling ways. And I think it's a must read. I really do. That's all I'll say. It's a must read.
And now we're going to finish off with two other nonfiction books. One of them, which Adrian sternly pointed out to me I had a conflict with, is called Gideon's Bible. And it's a very unusual book. It's by Rick Salutin, Gideon Salutin, and Dusan Petrichek, who is the illustrator. And I brought you over a copy, which we exchanged.
I liked it a lot.
At a distance. And it is Rick Salutin explaining to his child from a young age, what is the Bible and what are these stories about? And it's designed like a Talmud. So you get the story and then you get the commentary by both of them around the outside, all of it amusingly illustrated. And it tells you a lot of things about the Bible that I didn't know from quite a different point of view. And the reason I have a conflict is that I wrote the introduction.
I'm glad you said it first.
Yes, I did say it first. I knew you were going to hammer me with it if I didn't. Because I am, in fact, Gideon's godmother. So I have a slightly vested interest in it. But it is a very interesting book, and I'm going to send it to a lot of people that I know who are interested in the Bible. And you notice that I started with you.
Well, I just, you know, went into the first three or four pages, and I found it absolutely wonderful. And to have a really what is basically a comic book about the Bible, but it's so interesting and done in a Talmudic fashion, is really, really interesting. So I am going to sit down and read that, maybe dropping everything else for a while.
It's also about
so interesting.
Their relationship, because Gideon, in fact, as he was growing up, was always a person who never, who actually took Rick to a certain amount of task. You know, he called him on stuff that he thought was bullshit. So that's been interesting to watch too. So now we've only got 5 minutes left, and you are going to talk about our last book, which is called Nobody Ever Talks About Anything But the End.
Well, this is a book in which I have a personal interest, because it's a book about a woman called Tamara Levine, who is the daughter of a friend of mine, and Michael Levine, who many people perhaps know. And it's written by her sister, older sister, Liz Levine. And Tamara committed suicide a few years ago after a troubled life dealing with mental problems. And I think I want to read this because I want to read how the family dealt with that, how she dealt with it. And I think it's going to be a very interesting way of coming to terms with something that is deeply sad. And so it's perhaps not unusual for a sibling to write about that sort of thing, but I think it will be a very moving event for me, because I remember when Tamara was born, she was one of three triplets, and it will be, and Liz was her older sister, 4 year older sister. So I'm going to read that with a great deal of interest and, of course, compassion.
Now, Adrian, it is our task to come up with a cheery goodbye.
Yes, we will come up with a cheery goodbye. Mm-hmm. In fact, what I would say is spring is coming, sun is out. I am going to go shortly for my daily hour and a half walk, which by physical distancing, the best way to physical distance and still keep walking is to do it in neighborhoods, on sidewalks, where you can step onto people's lawns or into the road if you can't keep a hockey stick apart from people. And it's quiet walking down through neighborhoods. So we have been discovering neighborhoods. We went up and down through South Hill the other day, and then yesterday we were in Little Italy, and Parkdale is on our list. And then we will do the upper beaches. And you don't meet people, but you get your exercise and you get fresh air. And I think that's, you know, life as a pedestrian. That was the best guidebook I ever had to Paris when I went there as a student in 1961 was called The Guide, The Pedestrian's Guide to Paris, which was a wonderful thing. The person had never had a car and they had gone all their lives looking at building after building and telling you what would happen in every single building at every number. And so I think to become a pedestrian, a true pedestrian in a city is good as long as you keep that physical distance, and that the way to do it really is by going through neighborhoods and being able to keep that 6 foot distance among you. So, and I know you're a great walker. So what do you do?
Well, I head for the muddy parts. Toronto does have a number of wide open trail and park spaces. They are a little bit muddy at this time of year, but they are getting less muddy. And you can go down into the ravines. People used to say, well, Toronto's so flat, it's boring, but that's not true. The dimension, the vertical dimension goes down rather than up. It's true, we don't have mountains, but we have all of these ravines.
And they're like coulees. They're like coulees in the West, in Saskatchewan, you know, where everything goes down into the rivers.
Yeah, it goes
and they're
down.
They're wonderful.
Yeah. So you can walk in those and keep well apart from other people. And I've been doing some of that, and I've been doing some gardening outside. And that is very cheerful because things are coming up. It's very encouraging that when you planted something, it actually sometimes it comes up in a different place because of the squirrels, but it comes up.
It comes up all the same. Well, spring is coming, and I think we have to reorganize our lives so that we can get this reading done and so that we can also be outside in a disciplined way so that they won't forbid us in France. You know, you can only go for 1 kilometer a day. I've been talking to French friends. It's just agony for them because they can only go for 1 kilometer a day outside. And I would, and you would be very upset if it had to come to that in our country. Let's hope that people will take it seriously and be physically distanced and that we'll all be able to continue to walk as long as we can and do that.
Yes, as long as we're successfully aging.
so and making younger friends.
This is a show that is going to go on with real authors on the show, reading their books and being interviewed. And thank you to Facebook Live for making that possible. And thank you to the National Arts Center for providing the platform and pulling this all together and teaching us how to use Zoom, the left-hand corner. It's the left-hand corner. And let us look forward to a season of seeing real authors and their books on this show. So cheery goodbye to everybody. Wave, Adrian. Wave.
Waving, Peggy. Thank you for inviting me, Peggy.
Thank you for dragging me onto this, Peggy. You enjoyed yourself. Admit it. You enjoyed it.
Of course I enjoyed it, Peggy.
Enjoyed it. Yes. She'll get back at me later. So, goodbye. Bye.
Bye-bye.